I'm David Barber. I'm a distinguished scientist at UiPath, and my main role is algorithm development, so particularly generative AI. I think there are some fairly clear near future things we can see. Clearly, these models are getting much better at multimodality. So, you know, we are used to now interacting with these machines. We say, well, we type a textual query and then we see a textual generation. But these models are getting much better at generating other kinds of things. So now they're good at obviously generating images, increasingly good at generating video. But we'll also see other kinds of things. There'll be, they'll generate music and video, or they might generate, say, voice outputs, right, in response to a textual question. Similarly, there might actually be different modalities in which the human interacts with the machine. So it may be that I don't need to type anymore. I can just talk to the machine, and we can already see these kinds of systems in progress. But that will have a much more natural kind of interaction with these machines. Similarly, I might not be talking to a computer screen. I might be talking to something that looks more like an avatar, right? It might be something that tries to mimic a little bit a human in some way. So I think we'll start to have a much richer interaction with these machines in through the human experience. But I think these machines will also understand much more about us, right? Currently, you typically go online and you'll type a search query, but the machine has totally forgotten about things that you've asked in the past. It doesn't know who you are. It doesn't know what you asked in the past. It doesn't know what your preferences are. It doesn't know what your family is doing, etc. It doesn't know what your pet dog's called, nothing like that. But in the future, these systems, if we allow them, they could know all of that information. They know everything about you. Maybe they read all of your emails. Maybe they know your bank account. So that sounds scary, but it may also be very useful because they actually might be able to then alert you to things that are going wrong. Say, well, actually, do you know that something bad's just happened with your bank account, or that there's a better interest rate available from a rival bank? So there are all kinds of improvements that we can see, I think, in multimodality, in a richer understanding of who we are, but also in the sense that they can actually help us in our daily lives. And you know, maybe there are even interesting things you might speculate on a little bit beyond that, where you might say, well, actually, if they're looking at me as at my face, you know, maybe they will even start to understand my facial expressions or the intonation in my voice. They might understand I'm expressing a little bit of frustration or a little bit of anger or excitement, for example. And the machines that can pick up on that are clearly going to be much more interesting for us and natural to interact with. I think in the near future, you can see, you know, already that there are, particularly in the entertainment industry, you know, I think that's an area where new jobs will be created. It's now, thanks to these generative AI tools, you'll certainly be able to create, say, media content like films or even maybe personalized content, you yourself starring in a film, which is maybe even done in real time. You know, it could actually be, so I think there are going to be huge, interesting developments and new jobs in the entertainment industry. I think there are going, you know, in a sort of slightly more interesting directions even. We need to try to understand how to work with these systems. And this is a very different era, right? So if I told you, look, you know, here's a system that knows more than any human or any collection of humans could ever know, right? It knows a huge amount of stuff about science, about culture, about the arts, about business world, etc. And it knows a lot about you. How are we going to work with these systems to do things that we simply could not do before? So this is going to be a kind of a new era in how to work with these systems. You know, we need to, if I gave you, you know, Einstein is sitting next to you, and I said, well, you know, how are you going to make use of this person? Well, you need to learn what Einstein's good at, right? You wouldn't necessarily use Einstein to, I don't know, answer the phone about, you know, some query or whatever. You know, you're going to use him for a physics problem, right? So similarly, you know, you need to learn, or we need to learn in general, how to use these incredible capabilities to actually successfully do things which we simply could not do before. So to make an example that might make it a little bit more clear what I'm talking about, let's imagine something like drug discovery. And you might say, well, you know, I've got a particular kind of a molecular issue that I would like to address. Say maybe some cellular level at say cancer, but I believe there's some molecule that might be able to help sort of solve that or address that particular cancer problem. Then you might think, well, actually, look, why don't we ask the machine, actually, what for this particular cell type, you know, is there something that might be able to help? Now, the machine might then, because it's got this vast understanding of, you know, cellular biology, science, etc., it might be able to go there and think of some possible things that it might be able to do. And that actually then might require the machine to run experiments or ask the humans to run experiments. Then these results are come back to the machine and then they're fed back, and the machine then starts to think about that and give us some additional things that we can do. So working in a smart way and learning how to take advantage of these incredible capabilities is something that we need to figure out. And the market and the job market for that will be very, very different to what it is now. But so I think, you know, it's hard to predict what that will be. My personal view is that people will be working less, but they'll be doing more interesting things. Some of the biggest challenges we have in AI are making these systems reliable and robust and trustworthy. Quite frankly, you know, it's difficult to do that because these systems are, the way they're trained doesn't necessarily mean they get the answer right all the time. But those are, I think, the biggest challenges that we have right now. Also, there's a lot of concern about things like fake generations. So, you know, there are clearly bad actors in the space who could take advantage of AI. They might say, clone your voice or your image, or even make a, you know, fake video of you doing something. And so those are clearly things that we need to think about, and we need to address them, whether that means some kind of way of verifying that actually, you know, you're a real person, or watermarking these generations, you know, making that a legal requirement in some sense, or trying to detect when these things are generated, or maybe somehow there's a human verification capability in some sense, would be very, very important. But also I think we need as a society to think, you know, quite carefully a little bit about what we want to do with these systems. So they aren't going to be perfect. No, in the same sense that humans are not perfect. Largely these systems are trained in the way that humans are trained, and the data that they have is given from humans. So they have all the kinds of biases and foibles that, you know, humans have as well. So what do? Do we say, like, you know, well, that's not good, and we forget about all of that, therefore? Or do we try to work with these imperfect systems and you know, learn to, as much as we can do, understand their benefits and their downsides? So my personal view is that that's a challenge, because we're not used to that as a society, and I think it's something that, you know, it's not natural for us to think about that. But on the other hand, you know, these systems, the world is getting complicated, right? Already we have extremely complicated systems out there. If you think about a car even, or a computer, nobody really on the street is going to be able to tell you how that fundamentally works at the detailed level. But nevertheless, you trust them because they're reliable, that they work in the way that you think they're going to work. So that shifts a little bit the sort of the perspective on these things. Maybe we need to move away from society demanding that we fully, all of us, understand how these systems work and get an explanation all the time, to just that we are satisfied eventually that they do the right thing in a reliable way, so they work as expected, and test them sufficiently to make sure that's the case.